good, people? It's Bundy on Mike, 1878 Casuals. I'm here with Mad Face. Of course, we got English, and then we got the man Hollywood Patch. So we got a couple things, and then we're going to do maybe like a freestyle, kind of whatever comes to mind, just chatting it up. So the first thing we want to talk about, English is going to react to article from BBC Sports written by Simon Stone. For those of you that don't know, BBC Sports is as mainstream as it gets. And so Simon Stone has written an article about the Glazers and the timeline in which they're going to, you know, possibly sell the club. We'll get to that in a second. And then we've got Matt Bays. He's going to be talking about an article in The Athletic about the Harris Blitzer sports organization, possibly in for Manchester United as well. This is an American corporation ownership group of several American sports entities. So they were on the short list for the Chelsea buy. So it's a serious bidders. So first we're going to throw it to English. What was your, first of all, what was in the article? And then what was your reaction to it?
First of all, real quick, you know who you are. Congratulations, mate, on the new arrival. I'm not going to say names, but awesome, mate. Good for you. Can't wait to meet the new arrival. And what a great Christmas present, eh? The article really is it's a lot to do with what we discussed the other day. It's a lot of smoke and mirrors that you asked me, to be quite honest. I think the guy had a page to fill and had nothing much more to write. It's he outlines that the possible sale, again, possible, which is what we keep talking about, is possible if and when. He's not beholden to any of the restrictions that the Chelsea sale had. Well, it's two completely different beasts, right? Chelsea was a forced sale, right, by a Russian oligarch that was basically the government said, you've got to sell Chelsea because of your misbegotten gains. So I don't know why people keep drawing parallels, because like you said the other day, the original sale of Chelsea to Abramovich, right, okay, is similar possibly to what's going on now. But the sale right now, the Dodgers that just bought Chelsea, nothing to do with United. One point that he made in the article, which I think I've been trying to say all along, is that the sale goes through if the Glazers are prepared to accept the price, okay? So the Manchester United right now is valued at approximately $3 billion. That's what they're valuing in it, stock market, et cetera, et cetera. The sales price or the sale asking price for Manchester United could be anything that the Glazers ask for, right? So when we start going, well, people start equating how much is valued at, this is the sale price, it's going to do it. Right? If you've got a car that's worth $50, if you sell it for 100, you get 100, right? If you get 25, you get 25. So he's leading towards, I think, or insinuating that the Glazers are going to ask for a lot more than the valuation. He did also make a good point that whoever buys obviously has a lot of work to do at Old Trafford itself. That just Old Trafford before we start talking about training grounds and characters and everything else. And that whoever gets involved has to be willing to coffee that up. They made a point that I think is quite valuable, that if you buy Manchester United right now might be the chance of a lifetime, because the way the supporters are right now, the bad will, if you will, as opposed to the goodwill around the club, is kind of like a carrot and stick to possible buyers, because Manchester United comes around every decade, every 10
years. He did mention that the current ownership is so hated that it seems like anyone would come in and be celebrated.
Yeah, but his point is that when he talks about how they're exploring different avenues, doesn't mean they're going to sell. Doesn't mean they even think about selling. Different avenues, like Casey says, his fear, investors, they spend. Again, you've got to remember, as much as we hate them, the money they put out, right, and the transfer market, they're still businessmen. There's a reason they did that. You didn't just go, let's go spend 200 million quid, right? There's a reason, so that they're trying to attract, investors. They made a point. He also made a point. He innuated to again to us Old Trafford being replaced, if you will. And he's I felt I wanted to go into depth more on the feeling of Old Trafford not being replaced, as in you know, it's part heart, part and soul of Manchester United, the club, how long it's been there. And there are ways to renovate the club, you know, the grounds. And I, then in defense of the Glazers, I hate to say it, they have pointed out that that is an option, is to redo Old Trafford rather than to build new. So, you know, pretty interesting article, but I don't think it really said anything that we haven't discussed. In fact, I think you made it clearer. Our points of, well, they'll do it when they do it. And they'll ask what they ask. I mean, and that's...
You got to figure that, first of all, anybody that comes in and buys the club is going to be an instant hero because they're not the Glazers. And as far as the supporters are concerned, I don't know how you guys feel, but we can only go up from here at that point, right? And I mean, like in terms, like there's always the risk that somebody could buy it and will end up being in worse hands. And I know I mentioned that in a video and stuff, but you got to feel like with the Glazers selling, and I know it said that they're exploring sort of alternative options, whether it be investments from outside people or just an outright sale or something like that. You got to figure that they're going to need so much money that any investor coming in is going to say, well, then I want a majority interest or something like that in the club. And you guys can be still involved, but you can be fucked off down to your 10% or whatever it is. And then the new investor is going to have put so much money into it that he's going to, you know, I suppose, be entitled to a pretty big share.
The only thing in that article that bothered me was what wasn't in the article. And again, no one's talking about the football. Everyone's talking about the business. Everyone's talking about money. And yes, it's important. Yes, it's, you know, a big, big part of it. But, you know, we've got to talk about basics. We've got to get back to basics. We've got to get back to basic football. If you don't lay, I don't care if you build a brand new stadium. If you don't lay the foundation properly, the fucking things are going to fall down. We've got to get back to basic football, basic respect for one another, the team, the supporters, each, you know, and building that unity, building a team, building a squad, and going out there, playing football that we love and winning.
Okay? I think we're seeing that too. We're starting to see that, especially under Ten Hag.
You need to let the manager run the fucking place, right? Run the team and let the businessman do whatever. And the two worlds collide, but they don't. If you know, like I said, it's a business of football and it's a football business. You know?
Sure. Yeah, you're right. So the article was strictly on a business sense. It didn't attempt to, you know, talk about much about the ethos of the club.
But I
or
think
the fans,
that our football is getting lost in all this.
Yeah. So one of the things that a lot of people are in the financial world are reacting is that this may happen, or he's just kind of covering his bases in that. Patch made a very good point that the investment needed to compete with your city and your vermin, it's going to be so great that someone would demand such a high control of the club, a percentage of the club. The Glazers have already relinquished some, about 10% of the club control. So a major investment, you know, it's going to be another 20-30% ownership and control. The second point being, you know, the way the interest rates on the loan market, the numbers don't work for the Glazers because of the interest rates at the moment. So let me finish. That's two avenues, right? That's taking a loan, which they've done before, which they've ruled out because the interest rates would be too much. It's just going to add to the debt. That's one avenue that they've tried to make money. And if they could make money, they would have done it. The second avenue is taking an investor's money, but they don't want to relinquish power of the club without, you know, control of it. So it seems like they would rather just cut ties altogether and cash out. So this is what people in the business world are suggesting that this is leading up to. So I know, Casey, you were saying like, oh, you don't trust it, and they're gonna find something, and this is maybe another trick to get the supporters off of their back. What's your feeling?
I just see This is not just working for us. You guys were right. The value of Manchester United is about to skyrocket. Now, it's either the Glazers want to cash out now because it's a good sell, because whoever buys this is going to make their money. But it's going to take time. Anyway, I think the Glazers were looking for investors. But what I learned today is it's being ran by this banking group called the Rain Group or something.
Yes.
American-based. So one thing we got to realize is American-based. There's going to be Americans are going to be involved in the purchase. They're going to be in there. You can't take any Americans out of it. There's going to be Americans who want to buy the team, and they're going to be allowed to ride. Harris and Blitzer is how can I describe them? They're like, you know how people flip houses?
Yeah.
Buy a house, fix it up, sell it. They're not long-term. They've never been long-term. They buy the next big thing and grow, but the only thing I can say is there's nothing bigger than Manchester United. So they don't have deep pockets, but they can raise money fast. See, what we're going to have is we're going to have three different buyers. We're going to have the kid who loved Manchester United his whole life, the oil money that's just out of control, and the Americans. That'd be our three. The Americans, this group, they own a baseball team, a hockey team. They know what to do. They get teams, they build it, but then they usually sell. What we need is someone. You gotta fix Trafford. This ain't gonna be no 3-year, 6-year deal. You're looking about a good 15 years of your life. You need the owner. What bothers me, they've never done that. This is a major project to buy Manchester United, because you are going to basically, you're looking at it right now to restore this team back to dominance, breaks, and where we're supposed to be, because our fan base demands it. We expect. Well, the thing is, they're not bad guys. They're actually pretty good. What they do is they understand how to run a team.
Talk about it. They purchased the Philadelphia 76ers, an NBA basketball team, and
And they've done a wonderful job.
I don't follow NBA. I don't know how they performed, as far as on the court, but
they won no championship.
Increase their value. Okay, so they won a championship. They also own
They're worth about
an NHL team, New Jersey Devils, and they own Real Salt Lake, the MLS team.
Yeah, and
they own like these gaming streaming venues.
They got EA Sports teams. Yeah, they're all in it.
The way they've been described as like perpetual investors. They're always investing. They're always looking for something. It's quite diversified what they own and control.
But there's nothing bigger than this project.
Now, when you say they invested in the NFL team and the hockey team, they invested it, or did they run?
They buy them at a good rate.
Right, right. But they
fix up the stadiums. They make the experience better. It's like they bring you Disneyland.
Okay, so That's why I was talking about the football experience.
This is what you want to know, English. This is what you want to know. They get the best people in the right positions to run those clubs. Okay. They don't do that.
They're not like a market.
They get the best football people. Oh no, they're going to get us the best people. They're going to get us the best people.
They understand what their position is, and they understand their strengths and their weaknesses.
Yeah, they're not here to run the team.
You guys are talking just now, and you kind of alluded to something that made me think. We talk about the fan base, right?
The fan base don't want them.
Do you not think? Because I do, that the fan base is changing. Obviously, as times change, generations change, et cetera, et cetera. So the way you watch and enjoy. Also, you remember that. I grew up with United not being the team that you guys started to watch, United winning everything, going all the way to the treble in the 20s. Still best football team in the world as far as I'm concerned. But, you're conditioned to a certain result, you guys, compared to what I was conditioned to. And I think that the New York fans these days are conditioned to the bullshit that's going on right now. And maybe the following is watching Manchester United differently and feeling differently. We see it. I know I said it before, but we see it, the number of people that are in the pub with us.
Yeah.
And yeah, I'm curious how these guys like this would appeal to a new Manchester United fan base moving on, because at the end of the day, we all get older, we all fucking die. You know, it's changing the market. The American, a lot more Americans are watching it. So are they going to cater towards an American market? You know, it's...
Well, this is the thing that's not in their favor. They're American and the Glazers are American. And it's just too, it's kind of like too soon.
Bad taste in your mouth.
Because it's still a better feeling. It's a bad feeling. Like, even for me, I'm like, I don't even know. Do we want this?
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I look at their track record. Get a club, fix it up, sell it. Get a club. It's just too, like, it's not love to me, too. It just feels like you're flipping a house. It's not.
Yeah.
I want someone who loves the club.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. How does that transfer to the fan? Like, Mike, when you went to Old Trafford, right? You know, the let's say the older days of the United fans at Old Trafford, the feeling, the atmosphere compared to, you know, again, you know, the family.
It'll be corporate.
The family stay. Exactly. Now, there's a thing to be said for the old days, and there's also a thing to be said about the old days were not so good old days, you know what I mean? So, you know, there's the footy that I remember, and then there's the footy that I remember, you know?
Yeah.
And
the Premier League.
I feel like they will.
The Premier League has long since tried to, like, clean up its image and be family-friendly and international. You know, this whole thing about, you know, legacy fans, to call the match-going fans from Manchester legacy fans is such a joke, right?
Right.
So you're right. You're right, English. Are they going to pivot away from, the match going fans?
I don't mean they have to tear up anymore. Right? They've got, you know, it's like, I'm not expecting them to put up, you know, statues to the Red Army, but there's got to be.
Let me add this part. I don't know if they're going to go talk to the supporters and all that, like we want them to. I've never been in that situation before. This is a unique situation to.
Yeah.
Because whoever buys this club, you're going to have to talk to a lot of people.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, and
this is not. This is. Go ahead.
You were saying something about, you know, wanting fan involvement and an ownership that cares and will go to the city. How do you see this playing out?
Me?
Oh, Pat.
Oh,
you talk too much already. Come on.
Well, I mean, I think we could all agree it has to be a necessity, especially after all these years of, you know, hot air saying, yeah, we know how important supporter interaction is and da da da. They didn't give a fuck. So I think that's definitely a positive step into winning the fan base over, is saying, hey, let's be transparent. I want to chat with you guys. And like I said, whether it's realistic or not to expect them to, you know, do a bar crawl with the fucking locals like they did at Wrexham. But I mean, it'd be nice to have them be there and present and interact with the fans, or, you know, whether it's through some dumb fucking social media like Twitter, and the new owner's on, got a Twitter account and he's tweeting to all the fans, or whatever way they choose to do it. I think it has to be mandatory. And like I said, in the previous video, it should be expressly written in their contract. And if they're smart businessmen, then they will realize how important the fan base is. Because, and then to tail onto your statement earlier, English, about the, you know, maturing fan base and the youngers and all those guys. I mean, if anybody born in 2002 would have gotten a half and half experience, you know, half of the time, the first 10 years of their lives, we would have been still winning titles, Champions League, Premier Leagues and all that. And then the last 10 years have been shit. But I think there's still enough of the supporter that actually knows what it is they're seeing, you know, that is going to watch them regardless. I mean, we've been shit the last 10 years and we've all four of us plus the others have turned up to the pub every weekend regardless. So I still think there's, you know, enough people that truly, truly do love the club. And now that it's up for sale, perhaps see a light at the end of the tunnel. And, you know, you might even get more fans now as a result of that, because it'd be like, oh, I wonder what it's going to be like when they get proper investment.
Do you honestly think, apart from, you know, the people that, you know, that watch this and ourselves, which is part of why we started this, was the Glazers and discussion about it. Do you honestly think that half the fans that come and watch the new fans even know that this is going on? Yeah, unless they're watching, just come to the pub and watch the game. Apart from, watch this into game. Do you want to know what the green and gold is, or even know what when we see places out? I'm just curious.
I think so. I think so. In an information digital age, I think a lot of the fans know. They may not, like you're saying, there's fans on a continuum where people where it's our lives and it's everything. And then, the more casual fan who's just going to go and watch and maybe, watch the highlights or something like that.
I'd like to think anybody who spends be at the bar around us, I think they changed. Like, oh no, I got to get my shit together. Yeah. That group right there.
You're scared. They're scared of you. That's why.
Yeah, I think if they're
scared of you,
and I suppose I use this word loosely. I think if they're a proper United supporter, not a fan, I think a supporter is different than a fan. I feel like supporters much more, intimate and connected. Whereas a fan is just like, yeah, I'm a fan. It can be so casually said, but especially now with everything that's been in the press and, everybody's got a Facebook or Instagram or Twitter account. This would be all over everywhere. So, I don't know.
Hey, so listen real quick. Casey asked a question the other day. Was it Mike who asked a question about, it, apart from your own country, what team would you want, Manchester United country player, would you want to see win the World Cup? Was that you, Mike? Remember you asked that?
Yeah, I posed that.
Because I've just thought of one. Okay, so they're Deadpool bought Wrexham, right? So which superhero would you like to see by Manchester United?
Wonder Woman comes to mind.
Captain what?
America.
Wonder Woman comes to mind.
Oh, I got mine.
Look who?
Easy.
Oh.
Case who?
Well, first of all, you got to be rich, so it's got to be either the motherfucker Tony Starks, because he's gonna just do it. Like, I got the best. I got the best.
He's gonna.
Or Batman, and he's rich too. Batman's gonna get the best. Midfield, huh?
What?
Huh? In midfield?
Tony Starks, he'll probably play in the midfield.
Nah, Patch, he'd rather go fly around and shit.
Patch who?
I mean, this is a little off kilter and strange, but
be someone rich.
Is that a factor, or is it just assumed that any superhero we pick?
Superheroes are rich, aren't they?
Well, I'm just saying, like, is it, like you said, there was obviously Tony Stark or there was Batman. Those guys are rich, but are we applying money is no object to all the superheroes?
You're reading way too into this, my friend.
Not that easy a question, is it?
Well, because I was gonna say Spawn. I don't even know if he's considered a superhero, but he's brutal and vicious, and he wouldn't put up with bullshit. So I'd like that about him.
That's cool.
Mike? All right, nice one.
Bandito, who's yours?
I was saying it's got to be Bruce Wayne and Batman. He's got the
end. So terrible.
Go who, Casey? Come on.
Well, the Batman would be good because he would, sacrifice what he has for the good of the club. You know what I mean? He's just that type of dude.
Yeah.
Who?
There you go.
Batman.
If Batman
bought in goal too.
Yeah.
I just don't know what Spawn's gonna buy.
Spawn's gonna fuck shit up.
I love you, Patch, but I'm just hurt.
Spawn's
gonna can't buy anything.
Spawn's gonna get on a pitch and just like do John Luis Garma on people and shit.
Wait, I'm lost.
No, and then Sinatra's gonna say Spider-Man, right? And he's broke too.
I get in line though. If Spawn is the owner, I'll tell you that.
I don't know, mate. Sinatra likes that new Batman. So,
I mean, we'll be a fighting crew. We'll win every fight.
See, what an easy question. See,
we own every terrace. I'm sorry.
That's funny.
Superheroes aside, we do want owners to be. We want investment. We want someone who gives a shit. We want someone who lets fans have their voice, communicates with fans.
I'd like to know something major.
Go ahead.
they own part of Crystal Palace and they have to sell that first. That's another issue.
Oh, you're talking about Harris Blitzer, right? So
they have like 37% of Crystal Palace.
Batman does.
Christian Bale does. Yeah,
Bond does.
He's from Bournemouth.
I thought he was Welsh.
Let me ask you guys this. Would you be happy if you get all of those things in an owner that you're asking for and we're still a top four team only and we're not winning things? And
we're going to win.
If we start winning things, you know, and all of a sudden now it's instead of just, you know, the 10 of us on a Sunday at 4 a.m., now it's, you know, 100 people in there.
Right.
What do you think about that?
That gives me 90 people not to talk to, doesn't it?
I mean,
go ahead. You know,
I mean, they'll be giving themselves away, first of all, because they only started coming when we started winning. You know what I mean? So we would treat them accordingly. But I mean, it's always good to be around more United fans and stuff like that. But, you know, it's even better when you're around people that, you know, actually understand the club and know the club and aren't just a casual fan. You know what I mean? So I'd love to see more, you know, supporters at the pub at 4 a.m., even if we're playing fucking Norwich. Sorry, Jason. Norwich. I remembered. Norwich is the last game of the season. Norwich is the last game of the season at 4 a.m. and the game means nothing. We've already qualified for top four. The game doesn't mean shit, but they're still playing. So, you know, we'll be at the pub. You know what I mean? So it'd be cool to see more fans at games like that and stuff. So, you know, hopefully that would be a you know, a nice positive.
I think that you're talking about the value of the club. You know, because we were winning, that's why United was worth so much money. I mean, that's how we were able to sell shirts and jerseys and
create
the beast, because we were winning, right? So if you're not, it goes to show, if you're not winning, then you're not worth as much. Again, you know, we need to start winning games before to make us a viable project for anybody. I think Manchester United would always be a good investment to anybody. The level of that investment and the amount of the return, obviously, is going to be, you're going to sell more shirts if you win. You know, United is always going to sell, but you get to the point where, you know, back in the day, Newcastle, Forest, you know, these were desirable clubs. You know, not so much anymore. You know, again, we see what's happening with Newcastle, but Forest. I remember Forest when they were, you know, before you guys were watching football, perhaps you were even born, when they were winning, you know, everything. They were doing well. So, and they had following. So that's my thing about, you know, the fan base and the following outside of the city of whichever club you're talking about, whether it's Bournemouth, Nottingham, Newcastle. You know, when you're not doing well, those clubs, they have their homegrown support. But, you know, the sales facts for you see how many Newcastle shirts get sold next year abroad, you know, right? Saudi, here, China, whatever.
I remember seeing like where all these Leicester shirts come from, and you know where, you know, on that magical run they had.
So I think again, I'm just afraid that amongst all the financial stuff, which I know is important and necessary, the football's getting lost. The fact that we need a manager, we need a team, we need the youth. We've got to stop putting kids out on loan.
Are you
paying for this? We've got to build a football team again. And then, you know, listen, if you build it, they will come, right?
Are you trying to say something, Casey?
We have 10 houses.
Well, I was going to say, it's like you said, Jason, the fish rots from the head.
Football's
right?
Well run. Don't worry about the football.
So we'll play. You know, I think obviously the Glazers selling would lead to a lot of positive byproducts down the road, you know, being proper people in the proper positions, football people in football positions and businessmen in businesses positions, and they shall never cross. Well, you can do football people in the business positions, but not vice versa.
5 points really quickly. Business.
I know, yeah. But yeah, so, you know, obviously we have the right coach. I think we can all agree at the moment. He seems like he's very promising. He seems like he's gotten his transfer strategy down. You know, he just needs a team to support him. And I know that that's getting put in place and stuff like that. And then you need, you know, We've been calling out for a director of football for the longest time. You know, there's a couple more positions that need to get filled. And then, we started really winning when Ferguson was put in place, and then he brought all his guys in. He implemented his strategy, and it was ultimately, coming from Ferguson and David Gill. So, if we get another sort of formula like that, Ten Hag, and whether it's McLaren or Vandergaag, whatever his assistant coach is.
I think we've got to remember it took Fergie 4 years too, don't forget.
Yeah, it did. And we were calling for his head.
They were going to fire him.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, but so far, for me, so far, Ten Hag, so good.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So okay, we'll see what happens in January.
Let's bring up what a lot of people have the fear that new owners, they're going to want a new manager.
We'll burn their shit down. We'll burn their shit down.
I can't do that.
Literally burn their shit down.
We go spawn on their ass.
I will burn their shit down.
Yeah.
Seriously.
The fan base.
There's no one better than him.
Yeah.
The fan base is so happy with Ten Hag right now. It's exactly what we needed. Someone to take player control away.
Yep. I think any smart investor or potential new owner is going to see that and want and just leave it alone. You would hope, but I don't know.
Well, I think you touched on your point earlier too, though. We need people who do business and we need people who do football. So, the investors, the new owners, if you will, need to come in. They are not managers of football teams. They are not football players, right? They are businessmen, obviously. So they need to run the business. And if the manager is producing and is, hitting the targets that they set, then good to go. Otherwise, if they see the football team not performing, then maybe they have to address it. But,
yeah.
Yep. We need to do a debate. What three owners do you, out of the three, the guy who loved the team for his whole life, the Saudi money, State and the investment group.
Yeah.
They're okay. All going to have money.
People get in the comments and
tell us who you.
We read every, someone's going to read every comment that's out there. They're going to react to it. Yeah, we want to hear from you guys. Like, what's your choice? What's your favorite of the option?
I think
I've changed my favorite.
I think most people would perhaps say Ratcliffe just because he's the boyhood United fan. He knows what Manchester means to the city. He knows the city. He knows the club. You know what I mean? He's got all. I feel like he ticks all the boxes. You know what I mean? So.
I'm a little bit dubious about him now with his 3-year window, and the fact that he's a Manchester United fan, he knows the club, it could possibly be a way for him
in 3 years
get in the door. You know what I mean? He's a businessman. At the end of the day, it's a 3-year turnaround, as Mike was saying for him. He's a businessman. He happens to support United. United happens to be at the top of the table. Is that just a way for him to get in the door and do what he wants to do with the club?
But did Ratcliffe say that, or was that his people that said that? You know what I mean?
That was directly from Ineos, which is his business. So he's not going to come out and say that.
It just doesn't feel logical, though. I know what you mean, Jess.
Well, Ineos is saying that they would expect, to start turning profit. Start not to recoup all of their money, obviously, but start to make money year three. That's the way they've run their previous investments.
That doesn't seem unreasonable to at least start turning a little bit of profit in 3 years. I don't think that seems unreasonable because
United has lost two years in a row, right?
Any successful businessman, one of the first things they tell you, even Ferguson when he talks at Harvard Business School. You can't be emotional about your business, whatever it is, finances, your houses, football. You can't be emotional. We're fans. We're all emotional, right? These guys who are coming in are going to have to be businessmen no matter what. When Ferguson sells his first protege, if you will, the class of 92 that gets sold. How you can't be emotional about that as a coach, the manager, when you built this kid, you've seen him grow and but it befuddles my mind. We're emotional and we're not invested anywhere close to that. So is it a good thing if the owner is emotional about Manchester United? Because do we want someone?
I wouldn't have a problem with it.
Yeah, but do we want somebody who's going to make decisions emotionally? You know?
Sure.
So it's
valid question. I mean, yeah, I think we do want an owner that's emotionally invested in United. But perhaps, you know, like for example, if Ratcliffe is that guy, then perhaps, you know, you'd have that sort of moderator, which would maybe be his board, that tells him, hey, I know you're emotional about this, but you have to think about it like this or something. I don't know. There would be some sort of mediator in that thing.
You know what's the bank is, remember, it's an American bank.
But not if it's Ratcliffe. Not if it's
American bank.
Oh, the American bank is handling the sale, right?
Yeah, they're handling it. Another thing is, these three examples we have, they're actually the best of each example you could possibly want. This investment group is the best. You already know about the desert money. I feel like I'm being racist. Why do I feel like I'm being racist?
Yeah,
and then Ratcliffe. These are the best examples we could want.
State funded, right? That's what we're talking about.
State funded.
Yeah. State funded. These are the best examples we could want.
Yeah, because there's other bad examples of you know, investment consortiums. There's other bad examples of state funded. So probably the Dubai would be the, like you're saying, Casey, the best of that type of category. Ratcliffe would be the best, you know, single owner. And then, you know, and then there's even talk of, you know, Beckham and the class of 92 being kind of the front man of another consortium investment group. So
that's the emotional one we'd have to worry about.
Yeah. Well,
that's the emotional one we'd have to worry about.
I'd love to see Neville in a more powerful role at United. You know, I'm waiting for Rooney to come in for
Man. Neville?
Yeah.
Rooney will beat everybody.
Yeah. He'll kick everyone's shins.
You guys have to. I've said before. You need to watch that interview with Neville and the Day in the Life of a CEO. All right, his approach to business and his portfolio is amazing.
Yeah. So we know
talk bad about Neville.
We know that Class of 92. They don't. You know, they took on this Salford FC, and they've already come up with two divisions. So they're kind of cutting their teeth on you know, what it's like to be, you know, to run a football club. And obviously they don't have the billions that it takes, but they can be the front man, and they can be that. That's another thing.
Running it. I know he owns it. Is he involved in the day-to-day football or just the business?
Who?
Beckham in Miami. Is he?
He's the owner.
I know, but is he involved with the team or just the business?
That I don't know.
My technology gets no MLS anything.
It seems to me like he's involved in both.
Okay.
Because he's a, you know, he's ultimately a businessman himself now too, and has been for some time. So it would make sense for him to, you know both sides, and I'm sure he'd want to know both sides. I mean, he's that Inter Miami is his baby. You know what I mean? His second born son, second to United.
Yeah, but, I'm just curious. I don't really know much about what he's doing there.
All right, fellas, that's gonna wrap it up for us. Thanks for the chat on those. Again, 1878 Casuals, go ahead and get in the comments, talk about some of the stuff that we talked about. We want your opinion. We read all the comments. Our good friend from
Tell me how smart I am.
Was talking about, you know, Harry Maguire. So yeah, we do read all the comments. We appreciate everyone for watching and following. Yeah, go ahead and click that follow. Really helps the channel. Lets us know what you like, what you don't like. So again, boys, thank you. We'll see you on the next one.